The Supreme Court, the role of judiciary, the intention of the Constituent Assembly insofar as the Supreme Court was concerned was to make the apex court as the custodian of the federal scheme which the framers had visualized, the constitution they had so fondly made, and the fundamental rights granted to the people as enshrined in the constitution. The framers had no intention to put one organ of the government against the other. The idea was to check the arbitrariness of both the legislature and the executive. Rather than making it as the battleground for settling scores, they did wish to project it as impartial as possible and had sought to keep the judiciary away from the pressures of the government, legislature including. There was in fact no intention to make the judiciary override the wishes of the legislature either. Happily, the provisions relating to the Supreme Court were so designed that it acted as the guardian of the constitutional administrative system. The ideal of impartial judiciary was what the framers of the constitution sought to establish in the country. Aradhi Krishnaswamy Iyer had rightly pointed out the Constituent Assembly, while there has been no two opinions on the need for the maintenance of judicial independence, both for the safeguarding of the individual liberty and the proper working of the constitution, it is also necessary to keep in view one important principle. The doctrine of independence is not to be raised to the level of a dogma, so to enable the judiciary to function as a kind of super legislature or super executive. The Supreme Court over the years has served its role remarkably well. Though Article 131 restricts the Supreme Court to take up issues relating to treaties prior to the commencement of the constitution, also matters under Article 280 and 290. It did decide disputes between the Union Government and the governments of states or between states. In the case State of West Bengal, Union of India, 1963, the Supreme Court declared the unconstitutionality of the Coal Bearing Areas Act, 1957. In the State of Bihar, Union of India case, 1970, the Supreme Court held that the disputes of the constitutional, legal and not of political nature be taken up. The government of Karnataka challenged the power of the Union government to appoint an inquiry commission under Articles 131, though the Supreme Court had interpreted the said article generously. Another two cases, State of Karnataka, State of Andhra Pradesh 2001 and the State of Haryana, State of Punjab 2002, related to the distribution of river waters between the concerned states, and stated that these did not constitute part of the dispute arising under Article 131. The two cases were related to Article 262 and were hence not taken up for hearing by the apex court. Although the issue in the S.R. Bomai Union of India case 1994 was one of doubting India's federal scheme, as was asserted, the fact that the Supreme Court declared under the scheme of our constitution greater powers conferred upon the center vis-a-vis the states does not mean that the states are mere appendages of the center. The states have an independent constitutional existence. They are not satellites or agents of the center. Within the sphere allotted to them, the states are supreme. Let it be said that the federation of the Indian constitution is not a matter of administrative convenience, but one of principle, the outcome of our own process and a recognition of ground realities. The Supreme Court of India has protected the fundamental rights rather overzealously. The right to life under Article 21 is not merely the right to live. It is the right to live with dignity, to live with in a healthy environment, its scope extending to all civil human rights. Endorsing the views taken in the Motiram State of Madhya Pradesh case 1978, the Supreme Court in the Husainra Khatun case 1979 sought to include reasonable, fair and just conditions when acting on the procedure established by law under Article 21, condemning the practice of using handcuffs and fetters as torture of the prisoners, defiling the integrity, vulgarizing the society and fouling the soul of the country's culture. The Supreme Court in the Prem Shankar Shukla Delhi Administration case 1980 invoked Article 14, 19 and 21, declaring the handcuffing as the violation of one's personhood, a decision which has reiterated in the Citizens for Democracy State of Assam case 1995. The Supreme Court declared personal liberty, Article 21, as most precious, without which life would be worth nothing. In yet another case, Nila Bharti Behra, State of Orissa, 1993, the Supreme Court declared judiciary as the protector of civil liberties. In Delhi Domestic Working Women's Forum, Union of India, 1995, the Supreme Court asserted that speedy trial is one of the essential requisites of law, giving a meaning to the guarantee of equal protection of law under Article 14. The People's Union for Civil Liberties, Union of India, 1997, G.K. Basu, State of West Bengal, 1997, and Vishakha, State of Rajasthan, 1997 cases, the Supreme Court sought to prohibit arbitrary interference and custodial torture as a naked violation of the human dignity and harassment as against the civil rights of the people. The Supreme Court has done no less in expressing its concern about the impact of pollution on ecology and environment in numerous cases. Some of the cases are M.C. Mehta, Union of India, 1988, Indian Council for Environment, Enviro Legal Action, Union of India, 1996, Pitot Citizens Welfare Forum, Union of India, 1996, S. Jagannath, Union of India, 1997, M.C. Mehta, Taj Trapezium Matter, Union of India, 1997, M.C. Mehta, Vadkai and Surajkund Lakes Matter, Union of India, 1997, Bittu Sehgal, Union of India, 2001, and M.C. Mehta, Union of India, 2002. In the field of education and especially related to the rights of the minority, the Supreme Court has given historic decisions contributing immensely to the fields. Some such cases are Kerala Education Bill, 1957, 1959, the Ahmedabad St. Xavier Society, State of Gujarat, 1974, St. Stephen's College, University of Delhi, 1992, Mohini Jain, State of Karnataka, 1992, Uni Krishna, State of Andhra Pradesh, 1993, TMA Pai Foundation, State of Karnataka 2002, Islamic Academy of Education, State of Karnataka 2003, and P.A. Inamdar, State of Maharashtra 2005. The judicial review power of the Supreme Court together with that of High Courts has enhanced the position of the Indian judiciary. The Supreme Court of India, being the highest judicial organ, is an important institution in our polity. Over the years, it has proved its merits by being the custodian of the Constitution, protector of our federal system, and the defender of the fundamental rights of our people. Indeed, the Supreme Court has been able to attain and keep its grandeur, although it is not as powerful as the American Supreme Court. The American Supreme Court has empowered itself, though, through what is called due process of law, which has given its wide scope of power, including the power to protect the rights of the people and the Constitution. The Indian Supreme Court works within what has been described as procedure established by law, what has relatively restricted its scope of power. The American Supreme Court goes by the law as well as by its spirit, while the Indian Supreme Court goes more by the law than by its spirit.